Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Thank you, Elder, for this wonderful song.
Amen.
The message come to us today under the caption, "A nobody is somebody." Bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you. I stand at this pulpit, but I could only represent you spiritually as you strengthen me physically. Strengthen me, Lord, and let your spirit take control, not just to me, but to your entire congregation, so that we'll be a better people this day, we pray, through Jesus' most precious name. Jesus, while speaking to his disciples, and at the same time addressing the multitude, give them an insight as to what his coming will be like. And so he said that the Son of Man will come in all his glory, and his holy angels with him. And he shall sit on his throne of glory. And as a shepherd separates his animals, sheep to the right, goats to the left, just so when the Son of Man comes and gather all nations before him, in the fashion like the shepherd, that's how he's going to separate the people. And the Bible continues and it tells us that Jesus said to those that are on the right, representing those that are being represented by the sheep, he said, "Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." And to those that are on his left, representing the goats, he looked at them and he said, "Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." And then looking at those on his right side, he said, "I was hungry and he fed me. I was thirsty and he gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came unto me." And then, as if they are baffled by the statement that Jesus made, they ask him the question, "When were you hungry and we gave you food?" And I could imagine for Jesus to help them to understand a little more of what he was saying. He must have told them, "You remember when that particular family was going through a crisis? There was no food for them to eat. They went through economic hardship, and you knew that they were going through economic hardship. And when you went to BJ's, you did not just pick up for yourself, but you pick up a little extra so that you can bring it to them and they could get something to eat." They ask him the question, "Then when did we see you thirsty?" And I could imagine he said that, "You remember when you went back to that third world country and you saw that lady with two children, one she hangs on the left shoulder, the other one just probably a year or two older she held in her hand. And as that child she held in her right hand, he was there and he was sucking on his finger. And as the cold came down from his nostril, he used it as somehow to be able to quench his thirst and his hunger. And you didn't just look at the child, but you actually took a tissue and wiped the child's nose and you went across the street and you bought a gallon of milk for the mother." Then they ask him the question, "When did we see you as a stranger and took you in?" Said, you remember when that particular brother or sister came here to North America and had nowhere to stay, and you took them in. And you provided accommodation for them until they were able to help themselves.
Yes.
You remember when they had that first job interview, they had no money, but you take a Metro card and you give it to them. Remember the winter came and they had no coats. And your coat couldn't fit them. Had you given them your coat, it would be an oversized size on the back, and it would have made them seem as if they were off the street. But you took your own money and you bought them a brand new coat. Yes, when did we see you naked? Or when did we see you sick? And we visited you. He said, I'm not just speaking about a visit in the hospital, but I'm talking about someone, and we heard that Sister Johnson give out the advertisement as it relates to insurance. I'm talking about someone who could not have afforded health care. And you went to a third world country, you took your vacation, you organized into fundraising events so that somebody in a third world country could get better health care. When did you see you go in prison? Come unto you. Said you did not neglect those that were in prison. You didn't just brand them as criminals, but you saw each one as my son and my daughter. You went to minister unto them. For those that are considered to be on the left side, it says that you neglect every social service opportunity that you had to help somebody. In other words, he's saying that I blessed you not just to bless you, but I bless you so that you can be a blessing to someone, and you neglected to bless someone. So therefore, you are cursed into everlasting fire. And brothers and sisters, when we look at Scripture, we could definitely see that unless we do not help somebody as we pass along, then our living is in vain. And that's the Bible. But the problem with us is that we have our radars, and we set our radars that pick up at a scope level that we are on. And we set it in a way that it sees at our level, and at the same time it sees those that are above us. But we do not set our radar to scope down so that there's those that are struggling below the level that we are. We neglect them and we ignore them because we know nothing about them. Shared a story the other day. Some of you heard it already. I will share it again. I went, spoke in a church. After speaking, stayed back to have lunch. And I noticed that there was a lady, young lady, who was different. Different in the sense that how she dressed is not how our ladies dressed this morning. So that as I looked at her, my assessment on her was that she probably is coming from the shelter. When I looked at her, she hair was not neatly combed. Her hair was at the level that you see mine. And if you see it looking all over the place, I had a hat on my head. But her hair wasn't neatly combed, because there seemed to be gaps in her head. Some of her hair was missing. And I looked, and she sat by herself. She wasn't in company of any other persons. The tables, you could look at the tables, and you could see on each table there was a group on each table. And the groups were in conversation, but she was by herself. And she had two children. Allow me to say miserable children. Because one of them, just the little boy who probably was about 4 or 5, just couldn't keep still. He was doing something. I went to ask him to stop doing it. He turned from me and then he went back to it. I went again, and by that time I say, you know what, let me leave him alone. Patience running out. And then when she came to me, somehow the person I was sitting on the table with left to go back to the kitchen for a refill and getting some food. And she used the opportunity to come and sit next to me. And as she sat next to me, she began to tell me her story. She said, Elder, she didn't call me Elder, but rather the title that I'm using, Elder. She said, Elder, when I was 12 years old, my father took me to have an abortion to abort his child. And it was not at 12 years old I got raped by my father. I became pregnant at 12 years old when I reached the age of childbearing. And then as I looked and I saw how lonely she was, that somehow she wasn't in company of the other folks, I began to feel a sense of pity for her, in the sense that she has been neglected. And as I spoke to her, I couldn't help but remember the words of a song. The writer wrote the song. He says, I was passing by an orphan home one day and stopped for a moment to watch the children play. Standing alone was a little boy. I went over and I asked him why. And he looked at me with eyes that couldn't see, and he began to cry. And his words, I'm nobody's child. I'm nobody's child, just like a flower I'm growing wild. No mommy's kisses and no daddy's hugs. Nobody wants me. I'm nobody's child. Yes. And I ask her the question, where is your mother? Said Elder, at the age of 3, my mother died. And my father came and took me from this Caribbean island and brought me here. And I ask her the question again, do you have any brothers or sisters? And she said to me, Elder, yes, I do have brothers and sisters, but we are not of the same mother. And when I try to tell them of the demise that I have experienced with my father, they seem not to believe me, because their father told them that I was lying, and they got angry at me and they abandoned me. Then the words of the song comes back to my head. Says the little boy in his experience. He says, I look and to see people come and take the children as their own. But they all pass me by, leaving me here alone. Most likely they would like to take me, but when they see that I am blind, they leave me and take the other children. And here it is, I'm nobody's child. No mommy's kisses, no daddy's hugs. Just like a flower, I'm growing wild. Nobody wants me. Nobody cares. Nobody's child. So, brothers and sisters, I don't care how much we come to church. I don't care how much tithe and offerings we pay. And we ought to pay our tithes and offering. I don't care how more well we could preach on a Sabbath morning, but preaching alone is not evangelism, because evangelism without love is no evangelism. For these shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one for another. And there could be no evangelism without disciples, and there could be no disciples without love. As I spoke with her, She wasn't asking for handouts. She was walking. But brothers and sisters, imagine she has no biological family that recognize her as a family. The very fact that you have a family and they neglect to accept you as a family is painful within itself. The very fact to know that you have been raped by your father, you had an abortion, it is not an easy thing to go through in life. She told me, she said, the reason why my hair is dropping the way it's dropping and the reason why my hair of head is like as it is because at nights I cannot sleep. And as a result, my hair is dropping, and yet still she is nobody's child because she has no biological family. And for 3 years she's in the church, and yet still she is lonely without a church family. And this is not an isolated case. Every congregation has somebody in that congregation who is regarded as a nobody. Just about the same time, she told me of her experience. A member of a church in the Caribbean died last year, around October. Member of the church, born in the church. Went to kindergarten, must have dropped his little pennies like every boy, every girl, and sing, "Hear the pennies dropping, listen while they fall." Then he must have sing the song, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." Then went up to the primary division and sing, "Jesus love is a bubbling over, Jesus love is a bubbling over." And then he went up to the youth division, partook in the AY society, must have repeated the motto, the aim, and the pledge every Sabbath evening. Sing the song, "Volunteers, Volunteers, How I Love the Name." Must have served in the offices of the church. And now he became elderly. Got sick. Couldn't come to church. Got sick, couldn't come to church. He was recognized as being absent. Listen to me now. But he was not missed. You could be absent. "Oh, I didn't see Elder Shepherd today. I didn't see Elder Bowler today." Absent, yes. But when you miss someone, you would actually have the interest to call or to visit that person. For years he has come to, he came to church. Now he is sick and is not missed. One Sabbath passed, two Sabbaths passed, many Sabbaths passed, until one day he was found dead in his house. And the reason when they did the autopsy, the cause of death is not from the illness that prevented him from coming to church, but the cause of death was starvation. Well, our consciences have gone. Who are we and what kind of Christians are we playing when we are neglecting those that are unfortunate, when we are neglecting the poor, when those that are lonely, we do not want to associate with them because they are not in our classes. And someone might be saying, doesn't the Bible say that I've been young and now I'm old? I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Probably this brother was a sinner. Brothers and sisters, understand something, the Bible says that yes. But the Bible allows unfortunate people to come our way because they are a litmus test to determine whether we go to heaven or hell. I don't care how much Seventh-day Adventist we could be, unless we refuse to help somebody, then our living shall be in vain. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13 says, "Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its ability to salt, wherewith shall it be salted? It is good for nothing." And unless we are not being some kind of assistance to somebody or someone who is less fortunate than us, we are good for nothing. Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." There are two classes. Those that perish. The ones that perish are those that are good for nothing. And the good for nothing we identify in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13. No good for nothing will go into heaven as a good for nothing. We have to be good for something. And that good for something is to help somebody as we pass along. I don't know what happened to us sometimes. I don't know what makes us feel that sometimes we are better than somebody else. I don't know what makes us think that we could speak to somebody how we want and to respect some other people. Turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 2. And then we will pick it up from verse 17. Second Peter chapter 2. You know what? Let us, if you could take me back and let us start from 15. Second Peter chapter 2. I'll read from here. Did I get this? Just give me a second here. Just give me 1 second. First Peter chapter 2. Let's take it from verse 15. Let me see. I'm getting it all mixed up here. Okay, there we go. The text. For so is the will of God that with well doing we may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. Peter is asking us to silence foolish men. Don't curse back somebody when they curse at you. Just smile at them. People disrespect people because people think they are better than people. And if I think I'm better than you, I'm seeing you as a fool. So therefore, when I come and should I disrespect Elder Larson, I'm not just disrespecting Elder Larson. I'm disrespecting his entire family, his wife and his children. Peter is saying they're silent, ignorant people. In other words, don't curse back at them when they be coming to you to try to disrespect you, because nobody is better than the other. Smile back to them. Because you know what? People who don't have the intelligence to know how to speak to people are being arrogant. And arrogance comes from ignorance. And ignorance comes from foolishness. and foolishness comes from a fool. So if you want to talk down to me and you see me as a fool, well, both of us are fools, but guess what? I am the smaller fool and you are the opposite. And then you look at what he says in 16. As free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Don't use what you have maliciously. In other words, not because you are a little more educated than I am. You think you could talk to me how you want. Because there is something that is called common sense. And common sense does not come from books. Common sense comes from God. Bible call it wisdom, I call it common sense. And who are you to talk down to me anyhow? Brothers and sisters, once you're washed in the blood, and once you are covered with the robe of righteousness, nobody is better than you. Because you are a child of the one who created the entire universe. And if you are God, if you are a child of the God of the universe, therefore you are a child of the universe. And no less than the trees and the stars, you have a right to be here. And look at 17. Says, honor all men, respect all men. No one is better than the other. Let me tell you something. You could be you're better than me if you are the one that gives me the breath of life. You are better than me if you are the one that caused the sun to rule by day and the moon to rule by night. You are better than me if you cause the trees to drop their leaves in the fall and then pick up brand new leaves in the spring, then you are better than me. But if you are not the one, then we are equal. Honor all men. 17. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. There is a problem in the brotherhood. Because in the brotherhood, instead of love in the brotherhood, there is selfishness in the brotherhood. And where there is selfishness, there is preference, there is biasness, there is favoritism. In Grenada, we will say there is curry favoritism in the brotherhood. There is oppression and suppression in the brotherhood. Taking advantage of people in the brotherhood. Working for people and you know that they deserve a certain amount and you are cutting them short because you think they don't have money sense. Taking advantage. I'm going to give you an experience. Those of you who we're from the same area, don't think you know about who I'm talking about. The person is not from Montrose. As a boy, I remember my first job. The salary wasn't too big, and you're going to understand why I say that. But it was Christmas Eve. And already I had plans as to what I would like for my Christmas. I wanted two things. I wanted a banana harmonica. You know, like we call it. Fig mouth organ, the banana, they had the red, the green, the different colors. Well, I wanted a yellow. And I wanted a pan gun, where you know they had that gun where you had the different color shots that you roll up and you have the red, the green, and the different colors. So I wanted my banana harmonica, mouth organ, anyhow. My banana mouth organ and my pan gun with shots. Wanted that badly. So when someone told me about this man who wanted grass in his land to cut, I took the opportunity, went and cut the grass. Sister Desmond, I cut the grass in the yard. And as I cut in, I'm whistling because I'm happy. Because the money I'm going to get from that job, I'm going to take that money, pay a bus, go to Grenville, buy my yellow mouth organ and my pan gun And if there is enough money, buy a sweet drink. Sweet Christmas is not Christmas in those days if you don't drink a sweet drink. So I will drink my sweet drink. Soda, we call them here. I will buy my sweet drink and a pack of sweet biscuit. And come back up to Montrose. I cut the grass in the yard. Listen to me now on a sunny, hot Christmas Eve. I didn't take any breaks. I was sweating, and then I began to get hungry, but then I challenged the grass in the land. Cut the grass below the cocoa tree, the nutmeg tree, clean up the bananas, wherever there were dry leaves on the banana trees, on the planting trees, on the blogger trees, I cut them. And then I went at that time, the grass that I cut in the yard, it began to quail a little, it began to dry, so I got a broom, I knew it was Christmas. I got a broom and I swept the yard and I cleaned it up good. And every time I walk, I begin to sing the song, "Listen, Mama, I want you to tell Santa Claus to give me a banana mouth gun and a pan gun." And I didn't sing it at a low tone. I sing it at a high tone so that my employer will know what I need and give me the money for it. When I finished all that hard work and I went to him and I said, "I'm finished." He looked at me and he smiled because he knew it was a good job. He said, "Well done, sonny boy." Then he put his hand in his pocket and my eyes begin to bulge out. I begin to get excited. I didn't take a blink because I didn't want to lose anything. And I see that he pulled out his hand from his pocket. And I saw the money. It was a red paper money. $1. For all that hard work, he gave me $1. And I was disappointed and dejected. And the brother then, Peter says to honor all men, fear God. But this brother did not honor me for the work I did. He took advantage of me. And I'm saying that in the brotherhood, there is advantage and disadvantage. I want you to know that there is a God in Billiard that looked down upon every advantage and disadvantage that is taken upon the poor. Went back there, Montrose, and I saw someone going to Grenville. I told him of my disappointment, and he took my dollar. Told him what my pain and my hardship were. He took my dollar. And as he went to Grenfell, I never left the side of the road. I waited until he came back. Now when he came back, gave me a harmonica, not a plastic banana mouth organ. But the one he gave me, it was carved with wood, and there were two tins, a tin on each side, and he marked echo. Then he gave me my pan gun, and I had shots with it, and his mother bought a case of sweet drink for Christmas, and I didn't get sweet biscuit, but they also bought a tin of crackers and cheese, and I was happy. There's a God who looks down and see every advantage and disadvantage in the brotherhood. And when God is ready to lift you up, no man could pull you down. Because what God bless, no man curse. When God is for you, who can be against you? When God blesses you, you don't drink from your teacup. You drink from your saucer, because your cup will be overflowed with joy. Mighty God. What a wonderful God. Brothers and sisters, don't take any advantage on anyone. In society, there are those that are considered to be a nobody. But in the sight of God, a nobody is somebody.
What a mouthful. he will hold on to it. I'm telling you today, the lifeline is thrown out. Jesus is passing, the one who is to save. With that in mind, let us stand and sing as our closing song, 367. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying.
Brothers and sisters, unless God takes control of our lives, we cannot please him. Life for us will be one of selfishness.
Yes.
It will be one of pride. And it will be one of ignorance, and we will think that we are wise, but in the eyes of God, we'll be foolish. I want to make it in the kingdom of God. How about you?
Amen.
We all want to make it into his kingdom. But in order to make it into his kingdom, he must take full control of our lives. So that as we go through, this life will end, you know, make no doubt about it. But at the end of it all, we must be able to say that we help somebody as we pass along.
Amen.
If that is your desire, to help somebody as we pass along, why don't you leave your seats and come so we can pray together and be strengthened together. And like a band of soldiers for Jesus, onward,
Amen.
Christian soldiers, we will march. March unto victory as we march unto helping others. So as we sing the next stanza, I ask of you to leave your seat. And come and ask God to give us the power so that we'll live for him. Let us sing.
Though we are slighting him, still he is waiting. Child to receive, breathe with them earnestly, live with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Bow your heads with me. If you want to be included in the prayer in a very special way, we're still asking that you would come to the front. Because we need the power of God to beat away selfishness. Because when we are selfish, we cannot be godly. It's only when we are filled with his Holy Spirit power. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. Thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for the opportunity you have given unto us, whereby we can be co-laborers with you, so that when we labor for others, we're actually laboring for ourselves to make it into your kingdom. But Lord, selfishness is an obstacle. We pray that you will take it away from us. Anoint us with your Holy Spirit power, Lord, so that we'll be our brothers and our sisters' keeper. So that, Lord, we will be able to attend to the least of these, our brethren. Because we know when we do it to them, we're actually doing it to you.
Amen.
So bless us, O God, and strengthen us, and bless us in a way so that as a result of your blessing, we will be a blessing unto others, and they, along with us, will make it into your kingdom, we pray, through Jesus' most precious name.
Amen. Amen.
Rescue the perishing. Narrow way, patiently with them, tell them. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Shall we bow our heads? O most kind and heavenly Father, what a time it is to bring it right down to us practically, knowing that no selfish person will make it into the kingdom. Help us to be unselfish, not to keep everything for ourselves, dear God. But by the way, in fact, we're just a short span. As we travel, just help us to pass it on.
Yes, Lord.
Your word, your love, your care, everything that you have lent us, help us to help somebody on the way. Take us into your care and keeping, dear Father, and we, as we break, dear Father, to eat. Oh God, what a time it is that we always dishonor you on the Sabbath. Help us to keep our minds straight today, so that indeed we can gain that blessing. And we can help others on the way to the kingdom, we pray, for Christ's sake.
Amen.